Hi everyone, and welcome to one of my favorite lessons, Organizing Data for Effective Analysis. The scenario that we have set up here is that the zone has purchased some contact information from a distributor that just went out of business. They've sent us data in 50 separate text files, one file for each state in the country. The task that we're confronted with is to take this data in the format that it was sent to us and get it into our format needed for our spreadsheets that we use in the zone. Let's look at the data that was sent to us in this text file. It looks like just a bunch of company names and addresses put on separate lines. Our job is to get this data into Excel so that we can work with it and analyze it. But before we import it, it has to be in a format that can be easily imported into Excel. If we use Excel's data import wizard, go up here to data, get external data, from text, find our text file, import it now, hit finish, we just get stuff like this. We could go through each customer, highlight the six rows that contain all the customer data, then do a paste special, then transpose it to get it into the format that we need for our business needs, but for hundreds or thousands of customers, this is not very practical. We need to find a better and more efficient way, especially if there are 50 files that we have to go through. This one is just for Alaska. Earlier in the course, when I was referring to formatting, I was typically referring to how we could alter the look of individual or groups of cells in your spreadsheet. In this context, however, we're now referring to the format of the file itself. Excel is flexible enough to work with and open a wide variety of file formats. One of the simplest and most common file format is the CSV format, or comma separated value format. In a CSV formatted file, each time Excel encounters a comma, it interprets that comma to mean that there needs to be a break between cells wherever that comma resides. Let me use this first company, 65 degrees, to show you what I mean. If I were to take the first six rows of data and copy it into another empty text file, we get this. I'll now put a comma at the end of each row and put all of this data into one row by hitting the delete key at the end of each row. Now I'll save this file as alaska.csv. If I go out into that folder and find that file and double click on it, Excel notices that the file name ends in the CSV extension and automatically opens it in Excel. Excel then breaks apart that line wherever it finds commas, and you end up getting something that hopefully looks familiar to you. Please note that while it may look like an Excel spreadsheet that we perform all of our newly acquired Excel skills on, it's still just a CSV file. For instance, if I add something like a formula to this cell, equals this cell equals 99615, and we get the value of true. Now I'll bold and highlight it, and then save it. We get this error message telling us that we're about to lose a bunch of stuff that can't be stored in a CSV file. I'll go ahead and save it anyway and close the file. Now if I go back out and reopen that alaska.csv file, we see that all of our formatting is gone, and the formula is gone as well, and replaced with the Boolean value of true. If we want to save all the formatting and formulas, we need to do a save as and change the file type to XLSX file here. As we've experienced over the last couple of months, that is a fully functioning Excel spreadsheet, so we need to remember that if we start off with a CSV, if we want to save any of the cool work that we've done, then we must do a save as an XLSX file in order to make that happen. Now that we know the basics about CSV files, let's go back to the task at hand and convert all of this text data into Excel. There are a few ways that we can get all of this into Excel, but the easiest way is to copy and paste it. Let me highlight it all by hitting the Ctrl plus the A key. Now I'll copy it into memory by hitting Ctrl C. Now if I go over into my Excel sheet that I worked on previously and go to a blank sheet and hit Ctrl V to paste it all in here, and we're good to go. It puts each line of our text file into a new row in our worksheet. The problem is that we want all of our six data fields to line up across in six columns, so one row holds one customer. Currently, one customer takes up to six rows of data, and we just have a mess here. We could just drag each cell one at a time up here, but with thousands of rows, that's just not feasible. We need to find a solution that allows us to do this via a formula that does all of the work for us. The formula that we'll learn about here is named concatenate. Concatenate joins several text strings into one longer text string. It concatenates the pieces together. We want to take all of these cells containing text, also known as string data, and have it basically form a sentence for us. To do this, we just provide a list of strings of text that we want stuck together. If we go into our formula, we just add all of the cells of text data that we want added together, and after each one, we add a comma. The first text argument is A1, comma, A2, comma, A3, comma, A4, comma, A5, comma, and finally A6. Just by doing that, we get this nice long string of text. Concatenate is even more useful and flexible than that, though. If it has the power to add all of these text values in A1, A2, etc., it must be powerful enough to add in other chunks of text as well. Remember from before that for a CSV file, we need to have all of these values in this sentence, so to speak, separated by commas. Well, we need to have commas somehow placed between all of these cells in order for this column to work for us into a CSV file. Now, how do we do that, you ask? Remember from chapter 4 that anything you wrap in double quotes becomes a chunk of text. We can use that to our advantage here. If we go in here between A1 and A2, you do it by putting in a comma in here, then type double quote, comma, double quote, and then put a comma outside of the second double quote here. The concatenate function then knows it's supposed to add this quote, comma, quote chunk of text in between A1 and A2 in our sentence. If I hit enter here to check it out, I now see a comma between the company name and the address. Now let's put commas and spaces between all of these cells by copying the first one and then pasting it into all the areas between all of these other cell references. Hit enter, and let's see how we did. Looks good, so let's copy that formula down to the bottom of the page. This now introduces a slight problem. The first concatenation worked well. The second row, however, not so much. Since this formula refers to the next 5 rows, when we copy it down, the formula in the next cell does the same due to our referencing rules of Excel. The formulas in the second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth rows are all incorrect. So every 7th row is correct, and all the others are wrong. Wrong! So we need to determine some method of determining which row is correct and which ones aren't. It looks like each correct row ends with a phone number. In this next column, we need to create a formula that correctly flags each correctly formatted row. So, how can we flag the rows that end in a phone number, you ask? Well, it looks like both rows 6 and 7 end in a number, so let's pursue that approach. In row 6, the cell ends with 5 numbers preceded by a comma. The 7th row ends with 4 numbers preceded by a dash. There are a few ways we can do this, since there are dozens of text manipulation functions, but let's start one that gets us the 5 characters on the right end of the string. The write formula will do this nicely. Equals write, and then this cell reference, comma 5, close our parentheses, and what should be returned is a dash 0233. There's also a left function, but that won't help us much in this instance. So if I hit return, what do I get? We should have a dash 0233, but we just have a 233. We specified 5 spaces, but we only got 3. There must be something up with the concatenation of this raw data in the first place. The last piece of raw data is this phone number here, right? If I look at the phone number cell, everything looks correct. But if I click in the formula bar, notice that the cursor is blinking at us. It's blinking out here 2 spaces to the right of that 3, So the raw data that we're trying to work on is not very clean, or if we wanted to get a bit judgmental, we would refer to this type of data as dirty data. So when Excel grabs the last five characters, it's including those two extra spaces, and then this three, the three, and the two. It looks like we need to get rid of all the spaces surrounding the phone number. We could go through each of these phone number cells and manually delete the extra spaces, but for thousands or hundreds of thousands of rows, this would take days, and manual processes like that typically result in almost as many additional new errors as the ones you fix. So let's see if we can find a function that deletes all those messy spaces. First, let me put those nasty spaces back into the cell by hitting Control Z. There's a very handy formula called trim that removes all the spaces from the beginning and ending of its string of text without removing the spaces from the middle of the string of text. The way that we can apply that trim function is to go into our formula up here, and right in front of this A6 reference, I type in trim, left parentheses, and wrap that A6 with our new trim function. Add another right parentheses and complete it, and hit enter. It looks like all is now good. In looking at our text here in column B, it looks like a lot of our raw data is surrounded by those nasty spaces. So we can improve the consistency of our output by trimming all of those cell references. So let's go ahead and do that in case we or someone else that might want to use this data needs a clean version for their purposes. Remember, clean data is happy data. Now that we can see all the extra spaces have been removed from this cell in column B, let's copy it down to the rest of the sheet. Cool. Let me copy this formula in column C down as well. Every sixth row, we have that dash followed by four numbers. The last step is to determine which of these rows starts with a dash in our column C, because every row starts with a dash now. In the next column, I'll create a new function that will determine whether or not the text in column C starts with a dash. Let's look at the find function. Find will search through a chunk of text and tell you the location of where it finds our dash anywhere within a chunk of text in another cell. Let's try it out. Type in equals find, left parentheses, quote dash quote, and then a comma. Within text is this cell reference here. Hit enter, and hopefully we get a 1 here, and we do. If we drag that formula down, we see that all the other cells throw an error since its find formula couldn't find a dash in them. So we see that every row that has a 1 in column D is the one that we want to use. We could stop here, but I want to show you another formula that's occasionally handy. Rather than just letting these find formulas throw this pound value error, we might want to instead have it give us some type of text message. If we wrap this function in the if error formula, we can fix this. Let me insert if error, left parentheses here, and then go to the end of our formula and put in a comma. Next, we get to put in our error text. What do I want? Bad data. Bad. Right parentheses and enter. Who says I can't judge? That's a good stopping point for now. So we'll pick up from here in the next video.